I'd like to welcome you to the Namaqua Unitarian Universalist Congregation. Thank you for being here today. We're glad you're here. My name is Doug Stewart, and Scott Walker and I are your worship associates today. I use the pronouns he and him. This is a come-as-you-are congregation, and you are welcome here just as you are. I want to extend a special welcome to any visitors. We would love to stay connected with you, and so please sign up for our communications at the main entrance if you haven't got a little card to fill out. And we'll email you stuff, but we promise not to spam you. Here at Namaqua Unitarian Universalist Congregation, we foster a beloved community that celebrates diversity, strives for peace and justice, acts mindfully for the good of the planet, and inspires spiritual growth through a free and loving search for truth and meaning. This is the mission statement we created for ourselves. We honor the ground we walk upon and acknowledge this land as the traditional and ancestral homeland of the Arapaho, the Cheyenne, and the Ute nations and peoples. We recognize and honor the indigenous peoples as original stewards of this land and vow to reconcile the deep wounds that still shape our world today. Today's theme is around political angst, a growing feeling of concern that I, for one, have been having, for the past couple of decades. Scott and I thought it would be good to have a Sunday service that names aspects of this elephant in our collective tables. At the same time, Namaqua is a nonprofit. And as part of the separation of church and state, our legal system mandates nonprofits can't advocate for or against political candidates or political parties. For-profit organizations can make donations as much as they want, but not nonprofits. However, we can talk about policies and values until we're blue in the face, which I plan to do today. And we can certainly share how we feel about our political process and the state of our democracy. Before we get there, we have a few announcements. Coffee hour, as usual, is after the service today. Just follow the crowd around and the front door, and it's in the building behind me. If you're new to Namaqua or to Unitarian Universalism, after the service, we'll hold a getting to know you get together. Grab coffee in the social hall and join us in the minister's office, which is just a couple of doors away over there. So that's getting to know you, and just get to know each other. Apropos of today's theme of political angst, we have a book group going, and you're welcome to join us. We've had one meeting, join us for the second one, probably be a third one. We're reading Democracy Awakening by Heather Cox Richardson. That's going to be Tuesday, August the 6th at 6 p.m. in the evening by either Zoom or in person here. And there's more information, I think, in your order of service handout and also online. Our postcard writing campaign is still happening. You can pick up a packet of 20 cards, names, and instructions at the entrance back there. Please follow the instructions carefully and follow the script because it's all been thought through as far as what's most effective. And remember to print and not try to read my writing. Dana's gonna collect the cards and mail them closer to the election. So don't put them in the mail, she'll take care of that. So just return them here and word to Dana, Reverend Dana, yourself. Next Sunday, we will have a service on recycling, on the spiritual and symbolic underpinnings and what's happening now in Loveland on recycling. And that's led by Kathy Hartman and who else? Sue Matthews. Thank you, Sue. I saw Sue here too. So that'll be very informative and meaningful. And finally, thank you to everyone who's been involved in making today's service happen. It takes a village to make a beloved community.
Good morning. I'm Scott Walker, and I joined Doug in being a worship associate this morning. We light this chalice for the warmth of love, for the light of truth, and for the energy of action. Please join me in saying our affirmation. Love is the spirit of this church, and service its call. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, in truth and love, and to help one another. Let us share the spirit of love by greeting those around you.
I'll sneak in that bell.
Please rise as you are willing and able and join us in singing our opening hymn number 360. Here we have gathered. People who are any young at heart folks, children, you're welcome to come up here and help me read a children's story, a story for all ages. It's Democracy for Dinosaurs by Laura Brown and Marc Brown. Yeah, come on up here and we'll just sit down together. Yay. So this is Democracy for Dinosaurs. Democracy is a big word. But what the heck is all this about? Well, democracy is about sharing equal rights. And this says, sharing is a way of including others and not keeping things for all for yourself. You shared plenty of time since you were little.
you hope other people will share too. You probably know how it feels to be left out or included. Inviting kids into your game is also sharing. So here's somebody who's kind of on the outside, and this dinosaur says, let's make some room here. Want to play with us? So that's nice. Another part of a democracy that's really important is being fair. So being fair is a way of showing respect, like when your teacher calls on each kid in class instead of just a few. Keeping others from being a part of something for no reason is unfair to them. But here's this guy is saying, you can't play, this is our team. So this guy's feeling kind of left out. Here he is, he's being invited in. Good rules help make fairness possible. If the rule is that everyone who signs up gets to play, then following that rule makes it fair for all the kids who want to play.
I feel like people walk all the way to space.
The ball could go all the way to space?
Yeah. I just want to kick that ball.
That's all it. The way to he's got a good kick, doesn't he? That's good. So another part that's really important
dino just screams and it knocks down.
Yeah, that's right. So here's something that's important in democracy that says be honest. You are expected to be honest and tell the truth with your family and your friends and your teachers. If you mean what you say, if you are truthful, I can help you build a tower. But then if you say you'll do something but then do something totally different, then it's a lie. So she said, this dinosaur said, I can help you build a tower, and then she kicked it down. That's not very nice, is it? She should just help build the tower. Yeah.
Wait, did he lied?
Yeah. Keeping a promise is another way to show that you can be trusted. I will help take care of Willie, I promise. So Willie's the dog. And here they are out walking the dog outside, even in the snow, because she said she would. She's being honest.
I never lie.
That is good. That is a really good thing. It's really good to tell the truth. That's great. And this one says, respect free speech. That means you can say what you want. And so here's a teacher, and the teacher says, what do you think to the class?
Why is he just sitting on a table?
Why is the teacher sitting on the table? I think he's just kind of relaxed. I think he's just kind of kicking back. So don't be scared to speak up and say what you mean.
Why is Doug sitting on the floor?
Why am I sitting on the floor? Yeah. But there's something kind of, you can't just say anything you want, you know? Because here's an example of somebody who's in this crowded theater and there's no fire, and yet he's yelling, fire, fire. That could be bad because it's gonna disturb the movie and people might get stepped on. So you can't just say anything you want. And there is a Supreme Court justice who was a Unitarian who was named Oliver Wendell Holmes, and he's the one who said that in a Supreme Court ruling. So you have to be careful about saying anything you want.
I never say that.
It helps if you're honest and true and say what's true. Because if there really was a fire, you'd want to say that. Mm-hmm. And you want to stand up for democracy, I think, is the next one, I think. Yeah, look, there's a mess here. Yep, there's a whole mess here. And by putting our voices together, we can decide, hey, let's clean up this mess. And they're all working together to clean up the mess.
He looks mad.
That's really important to clean up the mess. And I think, yeah, and so you can ask, so you may be young today, but you and your friends will grow up and become new leaders. America needs you. The world needs you. So ask questions and speak up for equal rights and freedom. Together we can make a difference.
Fox?
We are the me in America.
Is that a flying fox?
That's a flying dinosaur.
Is that a pterodactyl with a fox?
face. It looks a little bit like a fox face to me. It does. Thank you. And if we can form an arch, we can sing the kids out. So we're going to form an arch, and we're just going to walk up through. Go now in peace. Go now in peace. May the spirit of love surround you everywhere.
Together each week to share our lives and to care for each other through whatever life brings. If you have a brief, personal, and non-political joy or sorrow you would like to share, please come forward or raise your hand for me to bring you the microphone. For those of you online, please share your comments in the chat, and our Zoom host will read them aloud. After each joy or sorrow, let's repeat the words, "We hold you in our hearts." And to get things going, I'm going to start with a joy. It's a pleasure to be back with the UU congregation. I was ill for the better part of a month. It is now resolved, and it's such a pleasure to see you all.
We hold you in our hearts.
And we've got some folks coming up. Good.
Joy and sorrow. Can you hear me?
Thank you.
Thanks, Kat.
So it involves my brother, who I've asked for prayers for before when he had a serious fall. So he passed Friday night. He was found. So the joy is that he doesn't have to suffer anymore. And the sorrow is that we'll miss him very much. He's my brother, John. So I'd like to ask for prayers for especially his two daughters, Megan and Jenny, and their children, because they're really missing him. Thank you.
We hold you in our hearts.
In our hearts.
Hello, I'm Jim. I bring you greetings from Dick and Carol Barton. I had the pleasure of visiting them yesterday at the VA hospital. It's almost a city in and of itself, but they are doing extremely well considering. Dick is working hard. The squash is in great shape, and he can handle our investments anytime, as far as I'm concerned. Carol's doing a great job. In hearing the story of how things went and all the things that were required to allow Dick to be able to recover from this event, all I can say is I think he must have been in the shadow of the pearly gates, and they checked his ID and found that he was a UU and put him on a bus and sent him back to Colorado. But anyhow, he is working real hard. This hospital is the state of the art, so he's getting everything that he needs.
Well, do you have words? Anyone else?
Thank you. I had a rather sad week. There were three deaths I was made aware of. The first one was a suicide, and it was the former husband of my assistant for many, many years when I worked at the museum. The second was the daughter of a childhood friend. She died at 56, and she had Down syndrome. And my dad absolutely adored her and would drive her from the little town we lived in to the next town over that could offer services for her on a regular basis. So he got to know Tricia quite well and just loved her. And the third one was my friend Kathy, who's my very best friend from childhood, I guess, that's still alive. And she called me and told me that on Tuesday her brother went into hospice. And I called to get his address on Wednesday, and she said, Fran, he died last night. So it's not been a great week, but in it just happens sometimes.
We hold you in our hearts. Anything on Zoom? Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, okay.
Can I share a joy?
Sweet.
Absolutely.
Thanks, Scott. I have a few joys. It's been an exciting couple of months. So in July, we celebrated Ocean's 5th birthday. And for those of you who don't know, I've been coming to Namakwa since he was 5 weeks in my belly. So I always feel excited to share another milestone with y'all. And the other really exciting milestone is that here in August, Clay and I will be moving into a space that is just adorable in Longmont and building a home together for the first time. So,
we hold you in our hearts.
And those of you who know Clay know why that's such a big joy.
Congratulations, that's wonderful. I'm Sue Pinkham, and I live in Estes Park, but I wanted to share the fact that both Bill and I met on Lake Winnipesaukee in New Hampshire at an Appalachian Mountain Club summer camp. And we were back there this summer with my daughter from Pennsylvania and her son and his significant other, my brother and his wife, and two of their kids and their kids. So it was a wonderful reunion. And my brother and I have been going there for 74 years. We figured it out off and on, not every year. And Bill has been going there for 83 years. So it's a real joy, and I wanted to share.
We hold you in your heart.
Hi, I'm Elaine. And I was really disappointed to have to miss the animal service at Kathy's house last week, because anybody who knows me at all knows I am a big, big animal lover. Anyways, but some friends invited me up to their mountain home, so I got to be in the coolness, and we got to hike and kayak and be together and play games. And so, you know what, just love and blessings to all of our friends. Family is so important, but our friends really enhance our lives. Thank you.
Some of you know Shirley Rawson, used to be here. She moved to Minnesota with her husband some years ago, and she's now in hospice. And so in our weekly email blast, those of you who know her, her address is there. And so if you want to just express getting your relationship with her, you can get in touch with her that way.
We'll light one more candle for the joys and the sorrows held in our hearts but left unsaid.
I'd like to invite you to join me in the spirit of meditation. I'll share a reading with us before we're through, in which you can picture yourself in nature. Please find a comfortable position. You may rest your eyes. Draw in a deep breath. And let it out. You can let go and notice. There is nothing else that needs to be done right now. Another deep breath in. And out. feel your body in contact with what is supporting you. Your feet are supported by the floor. Your seat and back are supported by the pew or the chair. The world is supporting you. Another breath in and out. You can let go and notice. There is nothing else that needs to be done right now. As we meditate, I read these words of Wendell Berry, who imagines himself going to nature. When despair for the world grows in me, and I awake in the night at the least sound in fear of what my life and my children's lives may be, I go and lie down where the wood drake rests in his beauty on the water, and the great heron feeds. I come into the peace of wild things who do not tax their lives with forethought of grief. I come into the presence of still water. And I feel above me the day-blind stars waiting with their light. For a time, I rest in the grace of the world and am free. Another deep breath in and out. When you are ready, I invite you to return to the here and now of us. Another breath in. Thank you.
Good morning. When I was asked to prepare this personal reflection, I was instructed that I should be brief. And although it runs counter to every cell in my lawyerly soul, I'm going to attempt to be brief. I think it's safe to say that the current political climate is contentious and hard to talk about. This morning, I'm going to try to talk about politics without actually talking about politics. More specifically, I'd like to discuss how we as Unitarian Universalists can navigate a small part of the angst-filled waters in our current political scene, and hopefully maintain our relationships with those who have opinions that differ from our own. This is a personal reflection. Your mileage may vary. If you've had a conversation about politics recently that was angst-filled, please raise your hand. Pretty much everybody. Yeah. It seems there's a lot of discomfort surrounding these conversations, These conversations can be a major source of annoyance, angst, and just generally unpleasantness. This is probably because our thoughts on the current political environment are important to us, and the beliefs they hold are important to the person that we are talking with as well. People feel strongly about politics. Let's not kid ourselves, politics are important, and people tend to hold on to their political beliefs very tightly. In many cases, the person we are talking with is not interested in, and in fact, are unwilling to change those beliefs. These facts raise the question, why should we even be having this conversation? Perhaps if no one is willing to change their mind, we could dispense with the need to make each other angry. I have several friends and acquaintances whose politics are totally unlike mine. I think they are hopelessly wrong, and they are convinced that I am just as wrong. We have from time to time bumped up against these differences in conversations. The following has proved useful to me at these times. Quote now, I have few enough friends, I can't afford to lose any. Our friendship means a lot to me, and I'm really not willing to lose it over our differences on this point. Continuing to talk about this isn't going to change either of our minds. Can we change the subject and at least disagree on this one? Can we agree to disagree? More often than not, this solves the problem. I believe it's a respectful and caring solution. Now, I am not advocating avoiding all political conversations. I think that respectful, reasonable political conversations are a valuable and fun part of life. If it's only when those conversations become less than respectful that they raise problems. If there's a chance of changing your mind, by all means, proceed with the conversation. Just remember that you should catch more flies with honey than vinegar. It is important to remember, very important, that it is possible to love a fellow human being who is deeply wrong. It is also worth remembering that the other person is just as convinced that they are right as you are convinced of your rightness. They are doing the best they can with what they have. I have an acquaintance who believes with all her heart that Tom Hanks is a child molester. Needless to say, we don't talk about that. She does have a few screws that aren't quite snug. Now, am I supposed to abandon this person as her mental faculties fade? Are we only to love those who think like we do? People come in all colors, sizes, shapes, and with all sorts of beliefs and mental abilities. But in the final analysis, they are all human and worthy of our love. That just because they are wrong in their opinion doesn't make them any less worthy or less human. Now, I want you all to place your tongue firmly in your cheek and silently think the following thought. It's enough for me to know I'm right. Thank you.
Thank you, Scott. And it's time for our offertory offering. Each week, you support the work of this congregation and all the ways we live our values in the world through your own generosity. In addition to supporting the congregation, one half of your plate donations today will support a local nonprofit, helping us to make a difference in the world beyond our walls. For July and August, we are donating half of our plate to Safe Lots, which supports congregations that allow the homeless to park their cars overnight in their parking lot and be safe overnight. Susan Moody coordinates this effort for our congregation. And so if you wanna, she coordinates the food and watch times when it's our turn. Please be generous.
Check, check. Check, check. easy because the election is nearing. You know it's crazy to see life in red or in blue. We knew these stories they tell to confuse us, as if someday we'd forget who we are, nothing new. Worried, that's what they want, is our worry. Wondering, what is a lie and what's true? Oh, it's crazy. They forget who we are, how love guides us. So we vote, that's a start. Then we build with our hearts. Yes, it's crazy, but we know what to do.
Thank you, Caitlin and Jerry. Caitlin wrote the lyrics. Collaboration. That's great. Thank you. Well, how is your political angst doing? My wife and I recently returned from a trip to Scotland. I was impressed by the friendliness of the people, the scenery of the Highlands, and the reach of history, with clans and castles going back hundreds and hundreds of years. 24 of us were on the week-long tour, several of us from the United States. At the start, we carefully avoided politics, but gradually these became apparent as we lived around one another. I discovered one couple who was of the opposite side of the political divide as I am. Perhaps I could have a political conversation with someone with politics very different from mine. Yet I didn't want to get into an argument. I just wanted to understand. The other side, which seems to comprise half the nation, seems almost incomprehensible to me. I resolved just to ask questions. At the next dinner, we happened to sit together, and I asked them what they liked about the political candidate of their choice. They waxed on and on, but they also mentioned other beliefs, which included not liking wind farms and their belief that Jesus does not allow suffering. Dessert came, and the dinner mercifully came to an end. I'll need to have political discussions with someone else. Now, I could just go about my life simply promoting my own political views and arguing against opposing ones. In the current political climate, that would be plenty to take on. But it seems to me my goal should be something broader, something like Edwin Markham's poem points to. He drew a circle that shut me out, heretic, rebel, a thing to flout. But love and I had the wit to win. We drew a circle and took him in. As Unitarian Universalists, I don't think we just get to disagree about the divide's circles, that my circle is better than their circle. We call upon ourselves to find a bigger circle that can take us all in. Piece of cake to include those who don't like wind farms, somehow believe Jesus doesn't allow suffering, or who are currently of a very, very, very different political stance. As I thought about this, it seems to me that freedom is a value that underlies this divide. Now, I have a deep appreciation for freedom, and I suspect you do too. And if anything, the other side of the divide thinks even more highly of it. Freedom, after all, is a value our country was founded upon. The Puritans came to this country for religious freedom, escaping from a world of religious intolerance. It's religious freedom that allows me to choose Unitarian Universalism and, in part, to speak before you today. And there's political and individual freedom. Back in the 1770s, our forebears rebelled against a government that imposed its will on us. The imposition of laws and taxes without representation were at the heart of the rebellion, as was the British government's continued escalation of attempts to control us, up to forcing us to house their soldiers in our homes. Can you imagine? Our forebears demanded, fought, and died for political and individual freedom, as we all know. Yet, when this nation was founded, these freedoms did not apply to everyone. Women and Native Americans were excluded as citizens, and when the Constitution was written, fully 20% of our people were held in slavery. Ridding slavery took a civil war. Women did not get the right to vote until 1920. The cause of equal freedoms and civil rights continues to this day. Freedom runs as a common theme through our history. Religious freedom, political freedom, individual freedom, independence from outside interference in our lives. Yet my freedoms are not unlimited. As I grew up, I learned that my freedoms could only extend to where your freedoms began. Now, I may be being unfair, but I think many of those on the other side of the divide pretty much stop there. My freedoms extend to where yours begin. We can respect one another, but don't tread on me. To my mind, COVID vastly reinforced this emphasis on individual freedom, starting with myself. My own sense of communitarianism took a major hit when I saw every other person as a possible infection vector that might kill me and those I love. Much better than us together was you away from me. In spite of myself, I felt the need to become more self-sufficient so I wouldn't need you. Remember those bare grocery shelves and toilet paper hoarding? I shudder to think of those times. To me, those times moved our social narrative backwards from recognizing our interdependence towards the individualism of every person for themselves. COVID replaced our faith in one another with fear from one another, reinforcing a desire for independence and self-sufficiency. I think our political climate is still recovering from that. I think I'm still recovering from that. On the other side of the divide, it must look like anything that might impose on my individual freedom is to be oppressed, is to be opposed. Taxes, for instance, they reduce my independence and my incentive to work, and others' incentive to work too, especially if they are redistributed to the poor. Out of my paycheck. Ronald Reagan's narrative of welfare queen helped deepen that divide. As if all people who are in need of a safety net are suspect. as if our taxes could not, as President Franklin Roosevelt said, be the dues that we pay for the privilege of membership in an organized society. Regulations impose on freedoms too. When applied to business, they reduce market freedom. So the less taxes and the less regulation, the more freedom. Here's Ronald Reagan again. Government is not the solution to our problem. Government is the problem. He was good at creating narratives. They were just the wrong ones. History demonstrates that it is the unregulated free market that brings things like slavery and monopolies and robber barons and spiraling income inequality. Now, it's absolutely true that governments can be the problem. Hitler's takeover of German democracy is the usual example, but various regimes all through history have choked individual freedom to the point of people fearing for their lives, for living their conscience. The obvious way to reduce this risk of government interference is to have less government. So cripple government by providing it less taxes, like Tabor. Is that the answer? Don't tread on me. But do you see how this is based on fear? Fear that government will do wrong by me. True, historically, there has been cause for that fear. We fought a revolutionary war to rid ourselves of that fear. But must we stop there? Is that all we can do together, to not tread on one another? What a lonely world that would be. There's an alternative. We all do better when we all do better. As former Senator Paul Wellstone used to say, and thanks to Jim Danforth for bringing that phrase to my attention. It's true, governments can be bad, even horrendous, but it's equally true that a certain type of government is a requirement for us to work together to solve our common problems and to create opportunities none of us alone could ever achieve. Plus, there's something insidious about that freedom at all costs movement. The flames of the freedom movement have got to be fanned by those who benefit the most from it. And those who benefit the most are corporations and the ultra-rich. To them, democracy could be seen as a threat, that we, the people, might vote to redistribute the wealth they are raking in. Some of them have got to be backing the freedom movement for all they're worth. As the watchdog nonprofit Common Cause says, Americans deserve a truly democratic, open, honest, accountable government. So does the world. As Winston Churchill said, democracy is the worst form of government except for all the others. Today, this American experiment in democracy is at risk. Let's step back. What are we after, really? What would our ideal society look like if we could vote for it? John Rawls was an influential American political philosopher who advanced an interesting theory of justice. Imagine, Rawls said, that before you joined a society, you didn't know what position you'd land in it. The thought experiment is that at your birth, it's a roll of the dice. You might land white, male, cisgendered, in a billionaire family, be brilliant, and have great health and athletic ability, and be destined for male pattern baldness. Or you might land in a southern inner city, black, trans, in poverty, be mentally and physically challenged, your father unknown. Rawls asked, if you didn't know where you were going to land in society, what sort of society would you set up? Rawls argued, under such a veil of ignorance, the society we'd set up would be a truly just one. Michael Sandel, a professor of political theory at Harvard, calls Rawls' theory the most compelling case for a more equal society that the American political philosophy has yet produced. A more equal society, but not necessarily an equal one. Under this veil of ignorance, Rawls argued, we'd set up a society that does permit social and economic inequalities, but only ones that work to the advantage of the least well-off members. So a society could offer markets with the market's incentives, innovations, and profits, but put in place regulations so that the market helps the least well-off members of society the most. This might sound oddly familiar to the ex-Catholics in our midst, as the concept of helping the least well-off is key to liberation theology, a concept a Jesuit named the preferential option for the poor. Preferential option for the poor. Help the least well-off the most. And we can trace this precious idea back way further than that. For heaven's sake, it's in the Bible. Jesus is quoted as saying that on the day of judgment, God will ask each person what they did to help the poor and needy. Whatever you did for the least of these, you did for God. That theology isn't completely bad in my book. It seems to me under Rawls' veil of ignorance, we'd have a society that would regulate business for the common good, provide a social safety net, promote common infrastructure, protect civil rights, and keep us safe, build our own castles. A certain government not only can be the solution, a certain government must be the solution, or there will be no solution. Only a certain government, a certain way of our being together, can incorporate our common voices to abolish slavery, gain a woman's right to vote, sustain us through the Great Depression, or address civil rights. Only a certain government, a certain way of being together, can create national parks, or interstates, or go to the moon. Only a certain government can bring about a justice that's what love looks like in public, as Cornel West said. It's the risk of not having that certain government that is the problem. Reagan. Which brings us back to bridging the divide. How do we bridge the gulf between the me's and the we's? How do we find a circle that can take us all in when our common value of freedom is too often based on fear? But we know freedom can also be based on abundance. To live from abundance creates its own sense of freedom, a much broader one. To move us from fear to abundance, we choose to live abundantly. We become exemplars, showing our faith in one another that not only we will not tread on you, we can walk together, talk together, appreciate one another, hold one another up through the tricky parts. When I'm headed out for a hike, traveling on the backcountry roads, and I pass a car going the other way, we drivers often exchange the little one-finger salute. I mean a good finger, and maybe a nod. It's a little recognition that I'm out here with you. It's a little recognition that we have each other's back. It's a little recognition of our interdependence. I think it's really time to highlight the Unitarian Universalist value of interdependence. We will create and nurture sustainable relationships of care and respect, mutuality, and justice. In Scotland, on our tour, we did continue to engage with that other couple, though we never talked politics again. I found they agreed with me over my concern of the harm football does to its players' brains. We listened to their extensive travel experiences, and of course, we shared the tour. I ended up deciding I wouldn't mind them as neighbors. They are my neighbors, after all, and we will regain our common ground of loving our neighbors as ourselves, as they are ourselves. Have faith, I tell myself, and act in kindness on that faith in love. Our mission, as I see it, is more than rubbing our hands together in angst, as human as that is, with the news of the day. Take a Sabbath from your news feed and see if that helps. A day of rest from your news feed. Our mission is even more than advocating for our rights and the better policies we perceive, though we absolutely must do this advocacy. Our larger mission can be to build faith in one another, to draw a circle that takes us all in, to create a beloved community that includes all of us. As we journey down life's road together, this can start by raising a finger and maybe giving a nod. Join me. And now, if you will, let's rise and sing number 140, Hail the Glorious Golden City.
We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we meet again. Join us for coffee and conversation in the fellowship hall behind the sanctuary. Just follow the crowd.